Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Welcome everybody. The first hour is over. We have got just one hour more. The Lord may speak to us tonight, today evening. Let's praise God. Praise the Lord. 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 Well, you've been hearing about God for the last 3 days. And morning 7 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 6 o'clock. I hope you are not tired of listening. Yeah? May God give us a receptive ear, a believing heart and understanding mind. Praise God. Praise the Lord. 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 Now there's only one or more. I hope one language will suffice. If anybody wants translation, please raise your hand. If you can manage with English, well and good. Glory be to God. So all of you are looking at my face, I'm looking at your face. Let us all look at the face of God. Hallelujah! I don't know when I conducted a youth meeting last time. When I was in India, for more than 25 years, every year we would go for the youth meetings. So perhaps in 25 years, I may have attended at least hundreds of youth meetings. Anyway, as you heard, God should speak to us. In one way, God definitely speaks to us. The question is, are we opening our heart and mind to receive the word of God? Very often, whenever certain people, or quite some people, listen to the word of God, their mind is already prejudiced, or rather their mind is already set. If I like this message, well and good. If I don't like, who cares? Can you understand? That is why some people, as soon as they are out of this hall, or out of this room, the message is deleted from their minds. Can you understand? You just press the button, delete. That's all. So, until you really, sincerely prepare your hearts to receive the word of God, it may not enter in. Worse, it may bounce back. You know what is bouncing? You send a mail to somebody, it bounces back. Oh, something is wrong somewhere. So, we can understand when it bounces back also. Anyway, may God prepare our hearts to receive His word. I've got the message here, but before that I would like to tell you a small story. Everybody likes stories. It is about a man who challenged God. Most of you, if not all of you, are youth who are seated over here. So, youth have got so much energy. It should really be channelized in the right way. So there was a young man once upon a time who challenged God. I think some of you may know the story. If you don't, you can listen carefully. So he said, "Hey God, you seem to be so powerful, so mighty. Where is your power? In the time of Moses, you burned the bush. In the time of Joshua, you brought down the walls of Jericho. In the time of Jesus, you calmed the storm which was on the sea. But where is your power today? I would like to see some of those things today." He challenged God. I don't know how many of you are there like that. So God took up His challenge. Okay, I will do it and show it to you. How many of you know the story? Raise your hands. Oh, nobody knows. So, this man took a chair. Many vacant chairs are there. He took one chair and he sat next to a bush. There was a bush, there was a wall. On the other side, there was the sea. He kept looking at the bush, looking at the wall, looking at the sea. Nothing seemed to happen. Suddenly God began to work. God sent a fire, not on the bush, but on the church. God broke down the wall, not the walls of cement concrete, but the walls of sin. God calmed the storm which was in the soul and not in the sea. But this man kept looking at the bush and not at the church. He looked at the cement concrete and not at sin. He was looking outside at the sea but not inside his heart. And he decided that God was not doing anything. Can you understand? Many of you make your own decisions. You decide God has not done anything. So he said, "Oh God, have you lost your power?" God quietly replied, "I have not lost my power. Perhaps you have lost your hearing." Hallelujah. So God has not lost his power. Many of us are not in a position to receive the communication from God. Again and again, God is trying to tell us something, but our mind is diverted, our heart is diverted, our thoughts are diverted, and we decide that God is not doing anything. Can you understand? So God is doing so many things, but until your eyes are open to see, until your ears are open to hear, until your mind is ready to receive, all those things are going to bypass you. God is doing so many wonderful, marvelous things. When you read the first two chapters of the Bible, you see creation. When you read the last two chapters of the Bible, we see eternity. See, what a wonderful God. One day there was a small child. They wrote a letter to God. "Hey God, in Genesis you created so many things. Have you stopped creating things today?" Can you follow? Where the Bible ends with Revelation, it doesn't continue beyond that. So today many of us think that God is not working, God is just sitting and watching at us. No, it is much more. God is definitely doing something. We have to be on God's wavelength. Putting it in simple words, our mind has to be attuned to God's mind. Our heart must be united with God's heart. Then we can understand the wonderful, great, marvelous things which God is doing for us. Before coming over here, I was thinking and thinking and thinking, what should I speak? And finally, I got a message. It is a radical message. Radical in the sense, you may never have heard such a message in your life. It may not appeal to you, but nevertheless, it is God's word for you, for me, for all of us. What is it? Today, many people do not want to change their mind, and they think that God is going to change his mind to suit them. Shall I repeat? Many of us are believers, many of us are Pentecostal people, quite a few of us are born and brought up in this faith, and still we have the guts to think that God may change his mind, whereas we continue to do what we want. Now, I'm not telling you something from imagination or fiction or from the newspaper. I want to tell you these things directly from the Word of God. So first I would like to show you many people, good and bad, who did not want to change their mind and at the same time expected God to change his mind. Find out whether you are one of them. After some time I will show you some people who quietly admitted, submitted, united their mind with the mind of God. So today find out which group do you belong to. Let's go through the Bible quickly. One of the first persons who wanted God to change his mind, yes, do you know who it is? It is called L-O-T, Mr. Lot. Someone please quickly read Genesis chapter 19, verse 17 and 18. Somebody please read quickly, with or without mic. Seventeen and 18. Not. All right. God bless. Glory be to God. Here we read about Lot. God saved him the first time. God saved him the second time. God saved him the third time. And still, his mind could not, did not, would not be united with God. Firstly, Lot is supposed to be staying with Abraham. But he's an independent kind of person. I want my freedom. I want to go where I want. Finally, he selected Sodom and Gomorrah. When he was there, he was captured and taken away. The second time, God delivered him. Abraham went, defeated the enemies and brought him back. What should he do? Abide in the fellowship of the saints. Again he wanted his freedom. Again he went to Sodom. The third time God sent the angels to protect him, to deliver him. Come out from here. But what is his answer? Not so my Lord. Many of you are saying, my Lord, my God. But instead of saying yes, you are saying no. Can you understand? So he wants freedom to do his will. He doesn't want freedom to obey the counsel of God or the counsel of the angels of God. Not so, my Lord. You are telling me to go there. I want to go here. Let me go to the city. Can you understand? God gave him three chances. What was his reply? He didn't say, I'll say yes, Lord, yes to your will and to your way. I say, no, Lord, no to your will and your way. Can you understand? So, the New Testament in 2 Peter, the Lord is supposed to be a righteous person. But see this righteous person or self-righteous person. Instead of saying yes, he's saying no. He wants the angels of God to change their mind. And what did the angels of God say? Okay, in this also we will help you. Not so, my Lord. Yeah? So many times in your life, look into your own heart. You have said, not so, my Lord. Today, change your mind. Don't expect God to change his mind. This man went into the city. Finally, he went into the cave. That was the end of it. So, be careful. God is giving you first chance, second chance, third chance. Don't say, not so, not so, not so. Say, yes, Lord. He said, not so. He sealed his own fate. Very often, many of us don't want to change our mind. But we want God and the servants of God to change their mind concerning us. Now we come to the second person. His name was Moses. Read Exodus chapter 3 verse 12. If you are reading, please lift up your Bible and read it loudly. Anybody? First row, last row, middle row. Continue.
Thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt. Ye shall serve God upon this mountain.
Continue, continue.
And Moses said unto God, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, the God of your fathers has sent me unto you. And they shall say unto me, what is his name, and what shall I say unto them?
That's enough. So here, God told Moses, I have a ministry for you. What was Moses' reply? He began giving all the excuses possible. I cannot speak. What is your name? Who are you? Will the people obey me? All ready-made questions. The beautiful thing was, God had all the answers to his questions. Moses was fed up of asking. So, don't question God. Rather, don't back answer God. You know what is back answering? He will ask you one thing, you will ask something in return. All these things mentioned in the word of God. I don't blame him. I don't blame you also. He was really afraid. Yo, God is calling me. Let anybody else go. I don't want to go. Can you follow? So no use arguing with God. Finally God got angry with him. I'm giving you so many chances. You're refusing all of them. And you better obey me. You see what I'm going to do to you. Can you understand? So here, firstly we see Lot kept on saying, no, 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 no. Here we see, good man Moses. What is he saying? Indirectly he is saying, no, 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 no. So many of us, we are born like that. God is giving us so many chances with our mind, with our heart, and even with our mouth. Sometimes what do we say? not so my Lord. Then we come to the third person. His name is called Balaam. When I was a believer, I had a problem concerning Balaam. I could not understand why God was angry with him. But once I became a worker, once I became a pastor, slowly God began to reveal certain things to me. So, what do we see about Balaam? Please read Numbers chapter 22, verse 18 and 19. Quick, quick. Yes, anybody?
And Balaam answered and said unto the servant of Balak, if Balak would give me his house full of silver and gold, I cannot go beyond the word of the Lord my God, to do less or more. Now therefore I pray you, tarry ye also here this night, that I may know what the Lord will say unto me more.
Yes, glory be to God. When you carefully analyze or legally analyze the words of Balaam, he was contradicting himself. In one verse he says, I cannot go against the word of God. In the next verse he says, wait, God may change his mind and then I will tell you what I can do. Can you understand? Number one crook he was. So many people with their mouth they say, I am willing to do the will of God, but God must reveal it to me. God has already revealed the will so many times and you have not done it. So God is not going to reveal it once more to you. Can you understand? Very clearly in the preceding verses, God told him, you are not supposed to go. So what is this man doing? First time I prayed. Let me pray second time. Let me pray third time. Let me pray fourth time. Perhaps God will change his mind. Can you understand? There are some people, in spite of God saying no, they keep on praying and praying and praying. Finally, God says, do what you like. Can you understand what I am saying? So with his mouth, he is saying, I cannot come. But with his heart, you wait for some time. I'll pray. I'll find out what God wants to do. So when we read this chapter carefully, first, God tells him, don't go. When he repeatedly keeps on asking God, shall I go, shall I go? What did God say? Okay, do what you want. When he went, God was angry with him. Can you understand? So sometimes it's with you also. God tells you no, again you'll keep asking. God tells you no, again you keep asking. Then what will God tell? Do whatever you want to do. With his mouth he's saying, I do not want silver or gold. But what does the Bible say? He loved the wages of unrighteousness. His mouth was speaking something, his heart was speaking something else. Very often with our mouth we'll sing something, but where is our heart? Somewhere else. Can you understand? So all these people, they were saying, not so, Lord. Lot said no. Moses said no. Balaam said no. How many of you are saying no? With your mouth you say, I want to know the will of God. With your heart you will say, sorry, not now, later. So, let us not be double-minded. Let us not be double-hearted. Let us be sincere in the presence of God. Next we see another person. Very nice man. His name is Samuel. Please read 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 1. Sigramasi, quick. 1 Samuel 16, 1.
And the Lord said unto Samuel, how long wilt thou mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill thine horn with oil, and go, and I will send thee to Jesse the Bethlehemite.
So here we see that Samuel was praying for Saul. Samuel kept on crying, kept on praying, Lord, have mercy, have mercy, have mercy, touch him, save him, save him, save him. Finally, what did God say? Don't waste your time. I am not going to change my mind. Come on, now start doing something else. So what was Samuel trying to do? Samuel wanted God to change his mind concerning Saul. Many of you want God to change his mind, you don't want to change your mind. Can you understand? See, Samuel was a saint, but he was wrong as far as this thing was concerned. God told him, don't waste your time. You pray for something else, better things to pray for. Some of you will pray, 1 week fasting, I must pass in my exam. 2 weeks fasting, I must get a good job. 3 weeks fasting, I must get a good husband or wife. All these things are good, nothing is mentioned in the Word of God. You don't fast to receive the Holy Spirit, you don't fast for sanctification, you don't fast for anointing, but for all these unwanted things, you are ready to take fasting. Mommy, pray, daddy, pray, pastor, pray, chief pastor, you also pray. You don't want to change your mind, you want God to change His mind. How many of you want God to change His mind? How many of you want to change your mind according to the mind of God? All right, the list goes on and on. The next person is Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 6 and 7. Yes, quick, anybody? Girls don't want to read, huh? Okay.
Then said I, Our Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child. But the Lord said unto me, Say not, I am a child, for thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak.
Yeah. So Jeremiah gave excuse, I cannot, I will not, I am a child. When we give any responsibility, I am a child. But when you are in your school, on the road, on the college, then you show who you are. I can do this, I can do that. What is there that I cannot do? So God told him, keep quiet. You may be a child, you may be a youth, you may be anybody. When I tell you this ministry, you must do. So there are some bad people, there are some good people, there are some indifferent people. But sometime or the other in your life, many of you have said no to the Lord. Now, before I proceed any further, I want to see how much faith is there in your heart. If God asks you a particular question. Again, I repeat. If God asks you a particular question, what will be your answer? Will it be yes? Will it be no? You didn't understand what I said. God is testing your intelligence. God is not testing your ignorance. Can you understand? He is asking you something which you know. He is not asking you something which you don't know. Now, if God is asking you a question, what should be your reply? Should it be yes? Should it be no? That's right. Even before the question comes, whatever God will ask me, I am going to say yes. Yes is an answer of faith. What do some people say? When I don't know the question, how can I give the answer? What is the second thing? God may ask me something which I cannot do. God will never ask you something which you cannot do. To give you an example, God asked Ezekiel a question. Can these dry bones live? What did Ezekiel say? Lord, you only know, I don't know. He gave a back answer to God. God knows the answer, why should he ask him? See? So, the answer is there in your heart. We are asking you the question so that you may give an answer of faith. Reply. Can you follow? So, whenever God asks you a question, your reply must be affirmative. Your reply should not be negative. Affirmative means it should be yes. So, when God asked Ezekiel, can these bones live? What he should have said? Yes. God would have been so happy. What did he say? I don't know. Cain, where is your brother? I don't know. Hey, you know everything, still you are saying, I don't know. See? So, dear children of God, in these days when God is speaking to you, when the Word of God is coming to you, don't ignore the Word of God. Don't avoid the Word of God. Don't bypass the Word of God. When you reply yes, God will be happy. God will do so many things for you. Many of us, because of our fear, because of our ignorance, because of the fear of the devil or the fear of the future, even though God is asking us to make decisions, we keep on delaying, we keep on denying, we keep on ignoring. Simple example, Samuel was a small boy. The Lord came and called him, Samuel, Samuel. He ran to Eli, you called me. I didn't call you. Again, you called me. No. Finally, when God called for the Fourth time, speak Lord, for thy servant heareth. What will 99% of you people do? Lord, you speak to me in the morning, don't disturb my sleep. See, 99% will say like that. I'm not blaming you, most of you. I'm afraid, I'm scared, I don't know what you may ask me. Let me get up in the morning, then I will tell you. See, when God, when the opportunity comes, it may not be repeated. If you lose your chance, you are responsible. Like that man, hey God, where's your power? What did God say? Hey man, where's your hearing? I'm doing so many mighty things, but you are closing your eyes. You are closing your ears. Can you follow? Though God is speaking, there are people who close their ears. Like, please read Acts chapter 7. Stephen was speaking. What did the people do? They closed their ears to the word of God. Somebody please read. Acts chapter 7, verse 50. Where is it gone? Verse 57.
Then they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and ran upon him with one accord.
Yes. Instead of opening their ears, they opened their mouth. Instead of closing their mouth, they closed their ears. Can you understand? They closed their ears. Don't want to hear this voice. Such terrible people. Can you understand? So one way, they didn't want to hear the voice of God. We read it in many places. Take for example, the word of God is coming. It should enter into your ears. It should enter into your. But if the head is already full of things, how can it enter in? It just hits away and bounces out, finished. Can you understand? So until we prepare our hearts and minds, the word of God will just come and the word of God will just go. In these days, God wants to speak to you. God wants to do so many things for you. But you have to prepare your mind. You have to prepare your heart. When God asks you the question, don't look here and there. Immediately you must reply, yes Lord, here I am. When God called Adam, oh, I'm behind the tree. And God called Jonah, oh, I'm in the belly of the whale. He was in the wrong place at the wrong time. When God calls you, here am I, Lord, in this convention. What is your plan concerning me? So many people said no to God. Now we should be the people who are saying yes to God. So in the Bible we read about King Zedekiah. We read about Johanan. We read about the deceitful man. We read about so many people. In spite of God speaking to them repeatedly, they repeatedly said, no, 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 no. There are two ways of saying no. I wish I had a screen over here. I would write it and show it to you. One is called N-O. The other is called K-N-O-W. So when people say, I know, I start thinking what kind of no these people are saying. Is it K-N-O-W? Is it? Yeah, no. So when I ask you a question, what are you going to reply? Are you going to reply N-O or are you going to reply Y-E-S? Now I want to tell you the strangest thing possible. What is that? Jesus also kept praying, God said no. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed. What was the answer? Silence. Again he prayed. Silence. Third time he prayed. Silence. What does that mean? If you cannot understand his silence, how can you understand his words? So when God is silent, he is communicating with you. Some people say, God is not answering my prayer. Do you know what's the reason? Your prayer is not worth being answered. Huh? Pastor, I prayed so many years. What you prayed for, you only know. Many of you are praying for all unwanted things. Okay, I'll give you another catch word. I'll tell you another thing. There are at least three ways in which God answers you. First, He says yes and gives you what you want. Second, He says no and gives you something better. Third, He says wait because He wants to give you the best. But how many of you are willing to wait? Eh? What do you say? If God answers me, well and good. If He doesn't answer me, I have already decided to do something. Isn't it so? Whether God answers you or not, many of you have already decided to do so many things. That is why perhaps you cannot hear the voice of God. So we must be sincere. When we say, I want to do the will of God, you must be sincere. Then only God can reveal His will to you. But if you have already made up your mind, what's the point in asking God His will? Balaam had already made up his mind. If God says no, I will keep on asking Him till He says yes. I will tell you one real life incident. Not to make you laugh, but to make you think seriously. There was a man, he had three daughters. Daughters, sons, all are good. But somehow or the other, he wanted a son. He was praying, God, give me one son, give me one son, give me one son. Kept on praying. Finally, God gave him the son. After some time, the son became big. You know what was his prayer? Lord, take away my son, take away my son, take away. So there are some people, they just keep praying. They don't want to know the mind of God because their mind is already fixed. So today, especially in the evening meeting, God is going to speak to many of you. God has already spoken to many of you. But what you are saying? Not so, Lord. Not now, Lord. Give me some more time, Lord. If you keep dealing, you are losing your precious opportunity. When I was young, there was a time when I was not saved. I was in the world. But there was a time when I received the Holy Spirit and I was a child of God. So in my early days, in India, I studied in many places. First college, second college, third college, university, here, there, everywhere. And I had lots of friends, thousands of them. So finally one day I told some of my friends, I said, what are you going to do in life? I said, life, I am going to go and join the ministry. I'm going to serve God. You know what he replied? If you go and serve God, may God help all the servants of God. So, you can imagine what a kind of person I was. So, may God help them. That's all. So, there you are. So, when I look into my life, we are four brothers, no sisters. The first person was called for the ministry. He refused. The second person was called for the ministry. He also refused. I got a chance to serve God by default. You know what is default? Nobody is there, only one person is there. Come on, somebody, something is better than nothing. So when I stepped out for ministry, I was not really sure. I may be taken, I may not be taken. If God takes me, I'll be a good worker. If He doesn't take me, I'll be a good believer. Can you understand? So one day I had a dream. The center pastor was sitting here. I was sitting like one of you, sitting right in the front. Hey man, come and sit on this side. I say, hey, that's not my place. That's your place for the workers. I don't want to come there. You come. Lot of vacancies over there. So when I was praying, I came onto this side. Then I told that pastor, hey, so many more seats are there. Why other people are not coming? You know what happened? His face was very sad. God is inviting so many people, downright they are refusing the invitation of God. So even in this convention, God is calling you. But if you say, not so, if you keep refusing your chance, by default, somebody else may get that chance. It happened in the Old Testament, it is happening in the New Testament. In two places it is written. What is written? All the day long, I am stretching out my hands to a disobedient and rebellious people. God is inviting them. But what do they say? Get lost. We have no time for you. See? That's the colloquial way of saying. Many of you are doing the same thing. If you want, you can read that verse. Turn to the book of Isaiah. Yes, anybody found that verse? Nobody. All obedient children here. All right, Isaiah chapter 65, verse 1. 1 and 2.
I'm sought of them that ask not for me. I'm found of them that sought me not.
Mm.
I said, behold me, unto a nation that was not called by my name.
Mm.
I have spread out my hands all the day to unto a rebellious people, which walked in a way that was not good after their own thoughts.
I have spread out my hands all the day unto a rebellious people. If God is stretching his hands out towards rebellious people, how much more God will stretch out his hands and work for obedient people. For people who respond to the call of God. So God's hand is not short that it cannot work. But we keep delaying. Lord, I want to study some more. Lord, I want to enjoy the world some more. Lord, I want to do this. Lord, I want to do that. Whole day God is spreading out his hands to you. Finally, what happens? All the so-called good people are rejected. And the so-called bad people are selected. I don't say all the workers are bad as me or worse than me. But one thing is there. If you reject the call of God, God is going to give it to somebody else. Turn to the Gospel of Luke chapter 14. Luke chapter 14, please read verse 16, 17, 18.
Then say he unto him, a certain man made a great supper and bade many, and sent his servant at supper time to say unto them that were bidden, come, for all things are now ready. And they all with one content began to make excuse.
So, invitation is given. Come, everything is ready. What happened? All those who are invited, everyone rejected. All of them gave convenient excuse. I got a new house, I got a new wife, I got a new car, I got a new job, I got this, I got that. Can you follow? All of them rejected. So, the master was so disappointed. What did he say? You go and catch anybody and everybody and you bring them inside. And now read verse 21, 22, 23.
So that servant came and showed his lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city and bring in hither the poor, the maimed, the halt, and the blind. Mm. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. And the Lord said unto the servant, go out into the highways and hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled.
See, go and call all the useless people. Go and call all the unwanted people. Go and call them. Compel them to come in. See how powerful that word is. Why? All those who are so-called good people made themselves unworthy. So in this convention, only one meeting remaining. Don't make yourself unworthy. Respond to the call of God. Don't say, I cannot hear. Don't say, I do not know. Don't say, not so my Lord. Yes, Lord, you must say. When you say, yes, Lord, God will really help you. So, what is the decision you have to make? Sometimes I don't know, I'm undecided. How long will you be undecided? Today is the day. Now is the time. I will just show you the decisions of five people and then we will finish. There are many more people who said no. Now I will just tell you the decisions of five people. Daniel chapter 1 verse 8. Daniel decided in his heart, I will not defile myself. Today is a good day. You can make a decision. Yes, Lord, my eyes are defiled. My ears are defiled. My mouth is defiled. Sometimes I've defiled my own body. But nevertheless, according to thy word, I come to thee. From today, I want to lead a holy life. You must make a decision like Daniel. God did so many things in Daniel. God did so many things for Daniel. Second person, Solomon. He decided to build a house for the Lord. Yes, we must do something for the house of our God. We say the Holy Spirit is working. But what is the proof? It is the indwelling Holy Spirit which will outwork in your life. So one way the Holy Spirit is inside. Secondly, the Holy Spirit will urge you, or rather compel you, to make some decision for Jesus. In America, there is a magazine called Decision that is run by Billy Graham, who is supposed to be the world's most famous evangelist. We are not in America, we are in Singapore. We are over here in this youth meeting. You must make a decision based on the Word of God, not according to what comes in your mind. The Word of God will come to you. The Holy Spirit will urge you. When you submit to the Word of God, to the Holy Spirit, God will help you to keep that decision till the very end. Daniel decided to be holy. Singapore is one city which is very hip and happening. All kinds of things are happening here under the sun. But we want the Holy Spirit to work in you. Secondly, like Solomon, you must decide, yes, Lord, I want to do something for you. Thirdly, we see the decision of Ruth. What did she tell Naomi? Wherever you are, I am going to be. I am not going to be separated from you at any cost. Only death can separate us. So you must decide to be united with the servants of God, with the saints of God. Nothing is going to separate me from this fellowship. No trial, no relatives, no man. Nothing is going to separate me from the servants of God. Fourthly, David made a decision. I have made a covenant with my eyes. I have made a covenant with my mouth. Job made a covenant. David also made a covenant. So we also must make a covenant. Then God will work in our lives. Finally, Saint Paul made a covenant. We'll read about that and finish. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 2. Somebody please read.
For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified.
Yes. I have made a decision. What is that? I have decided to know the Jesus on the cross. I don't want to know anything else in this world. Why? The cross is the power of God. The cross is the wisdom of God. The cross is the will of God. The cross is the holiness of God. The cross is the mind of God. So if you really know and experience that Jesus who's on the cross, through that you can understand God's plan concerning you. Now, we have got only 10 minutes. Let's all stand. And then we are going to pray. We are going to give room for the Holy Spirit. You make the right decision. God is going to work in your life. The most Jesus could do was die for you. The least you can do is live for Jesus. Jesus gave His life for you. For whom are you giving your life? Jesus gave His life for you. Are you giving it for the world? Are you giving it for man? Are you giving it for self? Are you giving it for pleasures? Are you giving it to fulfill your lusts? Tonight, today evening, let us make a decision. Yes, Lord, so many times I have said no to you. Today, I decide to say yes. I say yes to your word. I say yes to your spirit. I say yes to your will. Lord, change all my no's into yes. Today, according to your word, I surrender myself to you. Let us not say no. Let us say yes to the Lord. Let us all quietly wait in the presence of God. As you make a decision, the power of God is going to touch you. The Spirit of God is going to change you. God is for you. Who can be against you? In all these things, God is going to make you more than a conqueror. Who can condemn you? Nobody. Who can lay anything to your charge? Nobody. Who can separate you from the love of God? Nobody. But there's one person, that is you. If you don't give room for God in your life, God cannot do anything. So today, let us surrender ourselves. Yes, Lord, so many times I have said no. Today I decide to say yes. Fill me with your love. Fill my heart with your love. I want to follow you all the way. The apostles followed you all the way. The disciples followed you all the way. The martyrs followed you all the way. The forefathers followed you all the way. These are they which followed the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. Dear child of God, as you return home from this convention, where are you going to go? Are you going to walk with Jesus? Are you going to follow him all the way? Are you going to say yes to him? Make up your mind. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. God is going to do great things for you. Firstly, you have to make a decision. Secondly, you have to count the cost. What is counting the cost? I am willing to give my best for God. I am willing to give my all for God. I am willing to give my all the time. I am willing to do my best again and again and again. When you give your best to God, God will give his best to you. When you surrender your all to God, God will be all in all for you. Dear child of God, close your eyes. Don't look here and there. Hearken to the voice of God. Jesus did everything for you. Are you willing to do everything for Jesus? Let us surrender ourselves to him. He is the Savior of our soul. He is our beginning and our ending. He is our beginning. No one before him. He is our ending. No one after him. He is our Lord. No one besides him. Once more, let us surrender ourselves into his hands.